For today's sponsor we have GVG Mall, where you can acquire your Windows 10 Home Serial Key for only $16, and using my SKAG discount code will get you 20% off, making it only $11. After the payment, you'll receive the key in your account, and after getting it, you simply need to introduce it in your Windows settings, and BAM! You have an activated system. Hello guys, the Shit Game Plays, I'm Fabio Pisco, and welcome to my channel. So for today's video, we are remaking a video called How to Fix Your Low GPU Usage and Low FPS. We had a 2020 and 2021 guide that was made in 2020, so now I am remaking this one on 2022 with more info and with more info and better done. At least, I think so. And just for that, I went back to my older background, just for the nostalgia. Now, how to fix low GPU usage and low FPS? Let's go to the first tip. So the first thing is actually the frame limiters, okay? By frame limiters, I mean like VSync, frame rate target control, Radeon chill, a frame limiter option in the RTSS, the Riva Thunder Statistics Server, included in the EMS Afterburner kit, or for example, an in-game frame limiter, okay? This will lead to low GPU usage due to the fact that, let's assume your GPU can do 100 FPS, okay? 100 FPS at 100%. Now, if you put your frame limiter to 75, it will mean that we'll cap the FPS at 75 FPS. And if your GPU can do 100 FPS, and it is only doing 75, it is normal that the load that the GPU usage will decrease. Now, will it be bad? Not actually, because the GPU is not being bottlenecked. It is just you that are limiting the frame rates. So if it can do more frames and it is just doing 75 instead of 100, it is normal that the low GPU usage will be there, okay? So if you take off your frame limiter, if you take off VSync, if you take off any frame limiters and the GPU is at 100%, then the problem is fixed. Otherwise, let's go to the next tip. The second one is CPU bottleneck. So there are several things that can cause the CPU bottleneck. For example, the fact that people don't seek the balance when making new builds. So you're building a computer and you build, for example, with a Ryzen 5 2600 and then you put an RTX 3080 or an RX 6800 XT. It doesn't make sense. So you're putting a really old CPU on a new GPU, a new and very powerful GPU, okay? And that will most likely lead to a CPU bottleneck. Now, does it always lead to a CPU bottleneck? Not really, because it has to do with the exact FPS in the exact scenario. For example, let's put it in a game where you're using, for example, the R5 2600, the Ryzen 5 2600, and the RTX 3080, okay? You're running, for example, at 4K, and at 4K that card can only push 90 FPS. But the CPU can also push 90 FPS as well. So your GPU usage will be at 100% because the CPU can actually push enough data to the GPU. Let's explain it like this to be easier, okay? Now, if you're running, for example, at 1080p, the GPU will be able to push, let's say, 200 FPS, but the CPU will only be able to push like 120. So hence the low GPU usage, because the GPU can push way more frames than the CPU can, hence the CPU can't feed enough frames to the GPU, hence the low GPU usage. That's basically how it works. It's a mix of several things, resolution, frame rates, and so on. So basically, if your GPU can push more frames than the CPU can in that particular scenario, it is a CPU bottleneck, okay? As for the ways to fix it, you have just one. Basically, overclock your CPU. If you have, for example, a Ryzen 2000 series or a Ryzen 1000 series, you need and you should overclock it. Ryzen 1000 and 2000 do benefit from overclocking all cores. For example, the Ryzen 7 1700 has a base clock of 3.2 and you can overclock it to at least 3.8 GHz, and that will definitely make your performance go up by a few percent. So imagine that you go from 100 FPS to 120 or 130, and that will make your GPU usage go higher as well, because the CPU can push more frames and the GPU is also doing them. So higher GPU usage. Intel CPUs also do benefit from overclocking, even if they are the 10th, 11th or 12th gen. As for the new Ryzen CPUs, for example the Ryzen 5000, they won't benefit as much from manual overclocking, but you can do, for example, Curve Optimizer, which will bring some interesting performance boost in some scenarios, as you can see for example in this video of the Ryzen 5 5600X versus 12600K, where I test stock overclocking with PBO 2.0, which is the Curve Optimizer, and overclocking with RAM, both for the Ryzen system and both for the Intel system, okay? So it will be really interesting to see. The third one is actually RAM bottleneck. And the RAM bottleneck can come in terms of several things, but the most, and the thing that happens the most, is in terms of single channel versus dual channel. Yes, so basically most people will get OEM builds, pre-built computers, that will only bring one stick of RAM. One stick of RAM means you're only running single channel, okay? Single channel versus dual channel means you're only having half the bandwidth on terms of RAM. So half the bandwidth will in most cases decrease your performance a lot. And even if it is a 16 gigabytes single stick of RAM, which is dual rank, will still perform way worse than dual channel single rank. And dual rank will perform better due to having double the bus width, okay? But that's a conversation for another video, okay? Now that you know that dual channel is a must and single channel will definitely decrease your performance, as you can see in this video of 1x 16 gigabytes versus 2x 8 gigabytes versus 4x 4 gigabytes, you also have another thing that you can do, and it is basically overclocking your RAM. So low frequency will also impact the performance, and people that say that it doesn't are dumb. Like I said before, if you're running 60 Hz or 75 Hz monitors and you don't want more FPS than that, well, even low frequency RAM will be fine if the CPU is also a good performer. But if you want high FPS numbers, memory frequency is a thing and is a must. A high memory frequency, I mean, because as you can see in this video, having for example 2666 or 3200 MHz will definitely have way lower FPS than higher frequency RAM. Not in all scenarios, if your GPU bottlenecked you won't have that problem, but if your GPU is strong enough to push high frame rates, then your CPU and memory will need to perform good as well in order to, let's say, accompany those high frame rates that the GPU can push. Otherwise, you'll have low GPU usage as well. Overall, the fixes are get dual channel, overclock your RAM frequency and timings. You can also use this video of how to overclock RAM in 2021. Or get, for example, more RAM, because if you're having stutters, if you're having texture streaming, then it is a problem most likely of RAM or VRAM. But in any case, get more VRAM. If you have only 8 gigabytes of RAM, get 16, because 16 is a must for 2022. Now, the fourth one is software-sided. And when I say software-sided, I'm not referring, for example, to the game engine or to the API or to the fact that the game is really bad optimized and that's why your super ultra mega CPU can't run it properly, or GPU, etc. That's not the case. When I mean software-sided, it is basically that your computer is a mess. Your drivers, your chipset drivers, so your GPU drivers, chipset drivers, BIOS updates, or even your Windows installation that is completely messed up. In the case that your Windows installation is completely messed up, then that may be the problem. So if you're running, for example, a game like Control, which is really, really GPU heavy, and you are, for example, being bottlenecked, then it is most likely not a CPU bottleneck nor RAM bottleneck, it can be software-sided. For example, you can have a bad installation of GPU drivers, so you want to do a clean installation of the GPU drivers. For that, you can watch this video where I explain how to do it with DDU and so on. You may also be missing, for example, your chipset drivers, which are your motherboard drivers. And they're really needed because they control lots of things. And even more, if you're using an AMD CPU, you absolutely need your motherboard drivers. They connect several things like the PCI bus, they control the power management, they do lots of things. And in some cases, not having the chipset drivers may even cause black screens and so on. So the chipset drivers are a must for good performance. Do a clean installation of your GPU drivers, install your chipset drivers, update your motherboard BIOS, because that's really important. Most people forget the basics, and if you're getting a new GPU, you also need to get the newest updates possible, okay? So if you're having a new motherboard BIOS, just update to your new motherboard BIOS to make sure the problems get fixed. Now, it may also be your Windows installation, like I said before, so if you're really in doubts and the previous things didn't fix it, well, just do a clean Windows installation, install once again GPU drivers, chipset drivers. If the problem is fixed, then you know that the problem was your Windows that was messed up. If not, well, you may want to take a look again at the previous and the following tips. Now, the fifth and the final tip is basically the game engine slash API. So, the game engine is a really, really interesting thing because you may have the most powerful CPU and the most powerful GPU in Earth.
Okay, because aliens have more powerful things and so on.
But if you're trying to play a game that has a really old engine, or for example, a really crappy one, you're gonna have a bad time. And I'm saying that because although you have a really powerful system, the game engine just can't take advantage of your powerful system, so your performance will still be a crap. For example, let's go back and play GTA 4. GTA 4 is an awesome game, but has a really, really bad optimization. Now, if you go with a nowadays build to play that game, like I tried, for example, with my Ryzen 5 5600X and the RX 6800, the game was performing like crap. And although I have a really good system that can run way more demanding games, I can't run GTA 4. And that's due to the game engine, which is crappy and poorly optimized. So I couldn't even reach 60 FPS in some cases, while I can do like 200 FPS running a game nowadays. So, as you see, game engine matters a lot. Now, what can we do to fix that problem? Well, the only thing that I think you can actually do is go into the game and see if the game has a new API. So the older game engines usually also bring older APIs, which makes sense. For example, like the X9 or the X11. And in some scenarios, if the game actually permits you the usage of a newer API like the X12 or Vulkan, like for example Ghost Recon Breakpoint that was updated from the X11 to Vulkan, you can actually use both. Rainbow Six Siege, for example, the same scenario from the X11 to Vulkan. And we have lots of games that went from the X11 to Vulkan. For example, No Man's Sky went from OpenGL to Vulkan. And the performance increases in the same game engine were insane. As you can see in this video, for example, of the X11 versus the X12 versus Vulkan, going to a new API on a newer system may help even with older game engines, okay? So if the game supports newer APIs like Vulkan and the X12 over the older ones like the X11 or OpenGL, just pick those APIs and the performance will get better. Now, just to really finish this, just take in consideration that the low GPU usage is kind of ambiguous, like you've seen in all the tips before. For example, GTA 5 is a really broken game in terms of online performance. If you go to the single player mode, the performance will be completely fine even on an older system. But if you go to the same exact game but online, the low GPU usage will be a thing for most users. So even, for example, on my RX 6800 and my R5 5600X with dual channel RAM and really, really good RAM frequency and timings, I am still bottlenecked, for example, at 1080p and 1440p, I will have low GPU usage. And I'm bottlenecked because my CPU and GPU can't actually play that game properly? No. It's the game engine and the game mode, at least, that's broken. Okay, if you overclock your CPU, if you get a better CPU, you'll have a bit more FPS, but the game is so broken that the difference will be minimal. In some other scenarios, for example, you can be running a game that's really GPU heavy, and even running it, for example, at 300 FPS won't make your CPU bottleneck. But if you go to a game that's CPU sided, well, even if you decrease the settings, you will still have the same FPS because the CPU slash RAM configurations can't push more. That's how it works. So guys, I tried to explain the best I could. Sorry if I was a bit confusing or if this was a bit confusing. But well, any doubts that you have, go to the comment section. Let me know what you think and leave your doubts in the comment section. I'll try to help you as fast as possible, as always, okay? That's what I can do apart from this. And hope you really enjoyed this video and hope that I helped you in some way. Thanks a lot for watching. Don't forget to like, subscribe and share this video, and see you in the next one. Yeah.